Hello everyone, I am Dr. Rupa Wong, board certified ophthalmologist, and today we're going to be talking about eyelid lift surgery, or blepharoplasty. So if you're interested in finding out what to expect if you have one of those surgeries coming up, keep watching. Welcome back, everybody. Thanks so much for joining me today. So I just finished doing a blepharoplasty surgery in my operating room. It's all clean now, which is why I can talk to you guys about this. But before we get started, I just wanted to share with you what this channel is about in case you're new here. I talk about eye surgery, eye health, kids' eyes, because I'm a board certified pediatric ophthalmologist, and eye makeup health. Just kind of run the gamut. So if any of that sounds interesting to you, hit the subscribe and the like and follow along and let me know what kind of content you want to create. All right, so let's get to it. Blepharoplasty surgery or eyelid surgery, AKA eyelid lifts. I always think that it's just so much better if my patients have a ton of information and if they're really prepared, because personally, that's what I like. I like to know exactly what's going to be happening as it's happening, so it just kind of makes my anxiety a lot better if I'm going in as a patient to any kind of procedures or just life in general. So that's what I thought I would share with you. Now, I'm not going to be talking about preoperative things, things that you should be doing prior to coming into your surgery. If you want that video, let me know and I will totally make that for you guys. So first, who does these surgeries? Who does blepharoplasty surgeries? So ophthalmologists like myself, general eye surgeons, we are trained in our residency to do them. Some ophthalmologists become further specialized and will do a 1 or 2 year fellowship in oculoplastic specialty. That's a fellowship training. I did my fellowship in strabismus, which is eye muscle misalignment. So I'm not fellowship trained in oculoplastics, but many of us do this surgery even as comprehensive ophthalmologists. Facial plastic surgeons. Facial plastic surgeons are ear, nose, and throat doctors who then do a fellowship training in facial plastics. They are also really good at doing eyelid surgery. And then the third group is plastic surgeons. So those are the three types of surgeons who you should be going to for your eyelid surgery. I would not go to anybody else for this. So when you come in, you'll check in to the operating room surgical center. I am an owner in an eye surgery center, so things are a little bit more streamlined than when I operate at the hospital. But regardless, you're gonna check in. They'll likely have you change your clothes into one of the hospital gowns and they'll get you all settled up. They'll have you, you know, do the blood pressure cuff, check your temperature, the whole shebang. And then you're gonna meet your surgeon. Typically, I like to mark the eyes in the preoperative holding area. And what I mean by mark is not just initial to know which eye I'm operating on, because typically I'm doing bilateral surgery on both eyelids, but actually make the marks with the marking pen as to where I'm going to be making my incision. I like to do it in the preoperative area because I like the patient to be sitting up because it simulates more what's their natural state. Some people will mark the patient when they are lying down in the operating room, and that's just a matter of preference, but I like to mark my patients in the pre-op area. So that's when I come in, I'll alcohol everything, and with a marking pen, make the ellipse that I'm going to be drawing. Basically, honestly, this takes me longer than the surgery itself sometimes. Okay, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but I pay very, very close attention to how I mark the eyes because the amount of skin, the shape of the incision that I make, all of that's going to affect your postoperative outcomes. So this is where I spend a lot of time. Personally, for me, it's almost like applying makeup on someone, which I love. So this is where I spend a lot of time. I use calipers also to make sure that I'm not taking too much skin. You want to be about 10 to 15 millimeters below your eyebrows, especially for what's called a functional blepharoplasty. A functional blepharoplasty is when the medical insurance covers it and pays for the cost of surgery because the droopy and excess eyelid skin is actually affecting your vision. And that could be a hot topic for a whole separate video as well, but that's what I tend to do most of. I tend to help my more elderly patients by removing that extra skin so that their peripheral vision is not blocked, especially superiorly. So what I want to do is just make sure I'm never taking too much skin, because if you take too much skin, you run the risk of dry eyes, of the patient not being able to close the eyes, and I never want to do that for someone. So The second thing I'm doing when I mark the eyes is I actually use forceps and I pinch in between and I make sure that the patient's eyes can still remain closed. So you might feel that. It's gonna be a little, you're not numb at this point, and you're gonna just feel the pinch of tweezers on your skin. And a lot of surgeons will do this just to ensure that they're not taking too much skin. You don't want that surprise look, right? So that usually is what I'm gonna do in the preoperative holding area. Then the anesthesiologist is gonna come in and chat with you about the anesthesia. The type of anesthesia for these surgeries is local. That means you are not put to sleep with a breathing tube. You're not being ventilated with an endotracheal or an LMA. But it's kind of like twilight sedation. So that means you might fall asleep during the surgery. As a lot of my patients are just like very groggy during it. I don't want them to be in any discomfort or any pain. So even though I'm going to give local anesthetic in the operating room, I still like to have an anesthesiologist give sedation via an IV as well. All right, so that's everything in the pre-op holding area. Then you get wheeled into the operating room. It's gonna seem like a lot of stuff going on. There'll be a lot of nurses up talking to you as you're looking up, and they're just gonna be connecting you to everything back there, right here, the anesthesia cart, you can see it. They're just gonna be connecting you to everything there to make sure that you're doing well during the surgery. Then the anesthesiologist is going to give you a little bit of medicine to fall asleep. Typically, this is when I give my local anesthetic. So I give little numbing injections, little shots along the area of the eyelid that I'm going to be operating on. And that can be kind of painful and a little bit uncomfortable. So usually the anesthesiologist might put you to sleep, but again, not with a breathing tube, but just with something called propofol, which helps you sleep for about a minute or 2 minutes. It burns going into your IVs. So be prepared for that. They're going to tell you, hey, it's going to sting a little bit, not just sting on the eyes, but sting in your arm where the medicine is going in. So that's normal. Then I do the injections, and then the nurse is going to get you all prepped and draped. They're gonna put the betadine on your face. I'm gonna make a nice sterile area for us to do the surgery. Then the most important thing I'm going to do is use these blue corneal protectors, and I put a drop of numbing medicine in each eye. Again, you're awake, right? Patients are awake for this. They're groggy, but they're still awake, so I don't want them to feel uncomfortable. I put a drop of numbing medicine in each eye and put the corneal protectors in the eye, and that just ensures that I don't accidentally cut the eye when I'm doing surgery, which obviously, as an ophthalmologist, I would never want to do. The next step, there's a couple different ways to do the incisions for blepharoplasty. You can do it with what's called a bipolar. That's these sounds, you might hear them in the operating room. I like using this. I feel like I'm just used to it. Again, it's a matter of surgeon preference. Some surgeons will just use a surgical blade. Others will use the Elman radio frequency needle. So kind of similar to the bipolar. Regardless, all of them have great outcomes. So it doesn't really matter which technique your surgeon uses, just whatever they're comfortable with. Like I said, I like using the bipolar. It cauterizes as I go. I'm used to it. I'm used to the depth of penetration that I need to make. Now here's another step where surgeons can differ. Some people will take an ellipse of skin and muscle. Some will take some fat at the same time. Some will just take skin. Again, total surgeon preference, and it's based on your eyelid anatomy. So really you're going to be looking at your before and after pictures for your surgeon and talking about it with them. I've never had a patient ask me if I was going to remove skin and muscle. I do a combination of skin and muscle for my surgeries. I don't take a lot of fat because my patients are older. If they do have some medial fat pads, then we can take that down so that relieves that poochiness that you get in the corner of your eyes. That's all we do is then we take the skin and muscle and then we stitch everything back up. And again, this is where I tend to spend a lot of time. Oh. But before I stitch everything, I'm just backing up a little bit. Then you want to cauterize. You're going to hear these different noises for the cautery. Sometimes you might even smell something like smoky, though we have a suction there so that you don't smell. Because I know it's a weird smell. You don't want to smell that. It might smell like burning hair. But there's cautery going on, which means basically we're using heat to decrease the bleeding and to stop any small bleeders. Because one of the severe complications you can get from blepharoplasty surgery is if there's uncontrolled bleeding. It can lead to something called a retrobulbar hemorrhage, which is an ophthalmology emergency. It can cause you to go blind. So never want that to happen. So I really take great care to make sure that I have a very dry surgical field and that there's no bleeders. Nothing is bleeding when I've finished operating. The other thing that you might see, feel maybe, but you really shouldn't, is I'll use a gel thrombin strip. So thrombin is actually found in your plasma and it helps with the clotting mechanisms. So you can actually get it manufactured. I use little strips and soak it in there and then apply it to the surgical field before I start stitching everything up again, just to get rid of anything that might be oozing or any little bleeders. And then I stitch. So again, lots of different techniques based on your surgeon's preference. I do a running stitch and I use a type of material called proline, which you have to remove postoperatively at the 1 week mark. I used to use an absorbable suture, which I never had to remove, but they stopped making it, so I was really bummed. But a running stitch is just when you have one long stitch and you just run the whole thing. If you know sewing at all, it's just you keep going, but not quite as easy as sewing. Some people will do what's called interrupted, which is when you make one stitch and then you tie it off, cut it, and make a second stitch, you tie it off, cut it. And so you might see your incision looks different than the way that I do my incisions. But again, it's surgeon preference, and really, it doesn't really make a difference. I've seen beautiful results from both type, absorbable and the type of suture that you actually have to remove. Some people will do subcuticular, where you don't even see the stitch at the skin surface. It's all right underneath the skin surface. So lots of different ways to do this skin closure, but it is important that it looks beautiful because this is what's going to help just make sure everything looks great. So then once the incision is closed, I'll put some numbing drops in the eyes and remove that corneal protector. And you might just feel like the light is really, really bright because we have all these operating room lights and they are bright. The protectors kind of shield your eyes from that brightness. So once we remove it, even though your eyelids are closed, you're gonna feel that brightness. So don't worry, that's normal. And then we'll put the little Steri-Strips. So then after we're done, what I'll do is clean you all off so that everything's nice and clean, and then put these little paper strips. They're called Steri-Strips. And they are little, tiny little bandages that go right on the eyelid. And then you'll be asked to apply ointment after the surgery, and you'll be taken to the recovery room, usually with a big ice pack over your eyes and with the head of your bed elevated about 30 degrees or so to minimize any swelling and decrease any bleeding. So a lot of ice and head of bed elevation is how you're going to be taken to the recovery room. And then they're just going to make sure you don't have any negative side effects from the anesthesia, and that is your surgery. So if you are interested in knowing the preoperative instructions or even the postoperative, I can make those videos as well. Just let me know in the comments. And all right, guys, I hope that was helpful. If it was, drop a comment below. I'm really trying to provide content that you are gonna find useful. So make sure that you like and subscribe. And until next time, I'm Dr. Rupa. I'll see you soon.